Hello there, very good morning. Joining us next is Konrad Sippel here, the head of research at Solactive. A warm welcome to you, because today we're discussing the fact that HanETF has listed the world's first electric charging infrastructure ETF. So this is a bit different. We're going to learn more about it and why the reasons investors would maybe want to get involved in something like this and what it means for the future of our generations, I guess. It's a great to see you, Konrad. So first of all, in your words, tell us what's happening.
All right. So thanks for having me, first of all. Right. I think what we're looking at here together with HanETF is, let's say, something out of the ecosystem of the electric vehicle. So we all know electric vehicles are the next big thing. You know, there's carbon net zero goals, the Paris Agreement, global warming. And there's these projections that in 2040, 60% of all vehicles will be electric, or to say an absolute 600 million electric vehicles will be on the road. Lots of countries are going to stop selling petrol-fueled cars by 2030, 2035. So we're really going to see like a steep increase. And obviously, that hasn't necessarily been lost. If you look at the Tesla stock price, you'll see that, you know, investors have bought into that theme. And what we're looking at is the charging infrastructure that's needed to actually get those cars fueled up as they're on the roads. That will have to look like the petrol station infrastructure that we know today, if more than half of the cars are electric. And we feel this is a part of the ecosystem that might not yet have seen the same sort of level of investor interest as the makers of the cars themselves.
I think that's a really good point. And it's all about widespread adoption, isn't it? Otherwise, this simply is not going to work. And clearly, we need more charging points.
Right. I mean, if you think about the people who drive electric vehicles today are the early adopters, the enthusiasts, and most importantly, also people who are fairly wealthy, because the models on the market are quite expensive. And that is going to change. So we're going to see car makers make electric vehicles in all sorts of price ranges. But what we see on the road today, dominated by Tesla, you know, this is wealthy individuals that usually will also have access to charging infrastructure, both at their workplace or at their home. But as we go mainstream, we'll have people who park on the streets who will need to charge their car on the way. And that's where the infrastructure that we have today is already insufficient for the number of electric vehicles that we have on the roads today. But, you know, to give you a number, in the EU plus the UK, a study that was done prior to Brexit, so it's EU plus UK, yeah. There's an estimate that by 2030, there'll be about 30 million electric vehicles. And roughly speaking, we're saying that there needs to be 10 public charge points per, 10 electric vehicles to one public charge point. That's the right way around. So you know, we'll need 3 million charge points. And today, the number is around 250,000. So there's a substantial need for that infrastructure to get worry free for the user, because that's the whole point, right? If you leave your house this morning in your petrol fueled car, mm-hmm. and you forgot to refuel and you got 100 kilometers left, you'll just go out and you know you'll find a gas station that is operational, will have the right type of fuel, the nozzle will fit into your car, your credit card will be accepted. And the problem with an electric vehicle today is that none of that is the case. If you leave your house with 100 kilometers or 100 miles worth of range, you need to go further than that, you know, that could be a real issue. And we need to sort of change that picture to it being completely natural that you'll find a fast charging station on the way.
Yeah, I think huge expansion is needed, and that's not an exaggeration.
No, absolutely. Yeah. And you know, the numbers are similar pretty much everywhere. The one exception I would make maybe in terms of an investment opportunity is China, where, you know, China is going to be the biggest market for electric vehicles, but unfortunately their investors will be left out in the sense of that most of that is going to be provided by the state. So the state-run utility companies will provide the charging infrastructure, but pretty much in the rest of the world, the expansion of the charging infrastructure is going to be left to the private sector, meaning that there is an opportunity for investors to get on board.
Okay, that's kind of what I want to talk about now, the opportunity for the investors. What is this giving investors access to?
Right. So in a way, right, you get access to a theme that plays directly into some of the, you know, hot ESG topics, carbon reduction, carbon net zero, because that infrastructure is going to be elementary in order to sustain the electric vehicles, which again is an elementary part of reaching our Paris Agreement goals. So there is an ESG sort of aspect to it, but on the other hand, you're looking at an industry where the underlying revenue growth is more or less guaranteed by laws that have already been passed, in a sense of that, you know, there will be a stop to the sale of fossil fueled cars. So that 60% number isn't some wild fantasy of those in the industry. This is more or less a fact that's given by binding agreements that have been put in place. And the investment is following suit. So in the US, the infrastructure pact that Joe Biden has passed recently, you know, over the next couple of decades includes $7.5 billion invested into expanding the charging infrastructure. And with this index, you're looking at those companies that money is ultimately going to flow to. You know, there's companies like ChargePoint who organize and orchestrate the networks. They're the biggest provider of charging infrastructure, charging networks worldwide, and they're very active in the US. And they're going to be somebody who's helping the Biden administration to build that out. And then you have also the hardware manufacturers. So all those charging stations also will need basically just the equipment to charge the batteries. So it's companies like Wallbox and others that really also innovating in creating better, more efficient, faster charging equipment to really help that EV revolution to get started. Because, you know, we talk about it a lot and we see a few Teslas on the roads, but it really hasn't yet reached mainstream at all.
And it seriously needs acceleration. I'm going to ask a really silly question, but I don't have an electric car, so I'm just going to ask it anyway. How much does it cost to charge up an electric car? Is it expensive?
Well, I mean, it depends on what you compare it with. So I think it's the cheapest and best way of doing it is charging at home, just at your regular home electricity prices, which you can optimize. It's even better if you have a solar panel or something on top of your house, because then you basically get that for free. I think that's one of the issues, is that fast charging at the moment still comes at a premium, right? In terms of, you know, so you do have to pay either subscription fees and then you get cheaper prices, or you pay sort of higher prices on the spot. It's very, very different from country to country and from provider to provider. And a lot of it is to do with the fact that this industry hasn't yet reached scale. So by the time this is a mainstream thing, I'd expect the electricity to not be more expensive than what you pay for, you know, operating a microwave.
Yeah, that's
however, right. If you compare the cost of charging an electric vehicle to the cost of petrol, and not just given sort of the current geopolitical issues around oil prices, but also, you know, before that in more stable times, it is significantly cheaper to operate an electric vehicle if you take cost for fuel per mile as a basis.
Mm-hmm. That's really interesting. I guess it also depends on each country, given how much each government of a country it is involved in prices as well. Konrad, thank you very much indeed. The head of research there at Solactive here on Proactive.
Thank you very much.